Welcome to Hopkins at Home. I'm Matthew Kahn. I'm the Bloomberg Distinguished Professor of Economics and Business at Johns Hopkins and the Faculty Director of the 21st Century Cities Initiative. I've co-authored a new book right here with Mac McComas that Johns Hopkins Press has recently published. We're delighted to have the opportunity to tell you about our new urban economics book titled Unlocking the Potential of Post-Industrial Cities. Just as Johns Hopkins competes with Ivy League schools for students and faculty, the six cities we study compete for people and jobs with nearby suburbs and other cities such as Washington, D.C. and Chicago. Our book is written for a general audience interested in urban issues. We first offer a recent economic history for the six cities that have all lost many manufacturing jobs in recent decades. We trace out the common economic trends these post-industrial cities have faced. We then pivot to the present and the future with a focus on how Baltimore, Detroit, and our other four cities can make an economic comeback. We focus on four dimensions of investment in people, firm growth, local real estate, and urban governance and public infrastructure. In spring 2020, I taught urban economics for Johns Hopkins undergraduates at the Krieger School. In addition, Mac and I employ dozens of undergraduates as research interns at our urban center. I've learned so much from our very talented Hopkins students. They tend to have a strong social justice perspective. They've made our book stronger as they've pushed me and Mac to think hard about how the urban poor benefit from local economic growth. The six cities that Mac and I explore in our study are six important American cities: Baltimore, Cleveland, Detroit, Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, St. Louis. These cities each have had a great past. Our book really starts in the 1970s. We are urban economists. We're not historians, but every city is informed by its history. These cities have had struggled over the last 50 years. And in 2020, like all cities, have had to cope with COVID and the challenges that families and firms have faced. We are cautious optimists that these cities each, there's a reason they were successful in the past. They have strong geographic fundamentals. They're enjoying now sharp environmental progress. And we live in an age post-COVID where there's a great demand to live in cities. Our six cities have great potential if certain strategic investments can be made. Our book features four interconnected pillars of investment. And let me tell you about this picture, since it's a little bit non-standard, but I know how talented Hopkins alumni are. So let me tell you about this wild picture that kind of looks like the solar system. In the middle of this solar system is success. And our definition of success is both for the people of a city like Baltimore and for the place. Success is for the rich and the poor and the middle class. Mac and I have a formula, and this is not a physics guaranteed formula. This is a social science formula for success with four components. A stronger Baltimore, a stronger Detroit will feature. Let's start up at the North Quadrant with people. We're going to be talking about people, young people and middle-aged people investing more in their skills, developing more health and human capital. We're going to be talking about investing in places. Baltimore has thousands of crumbling row houses. We can imagine a different set of economic incentives where real estate investors are investing more in the physical real estate assets of Baltimore, Detroit, and Cleveland. Now to the south, the business quadrant. We can imagine, and we talk through new rules of the game, such that there's more business growth in Baltimore, more African-American businesses opening up in Baltimore, more small businesses thriving, and major firms like Amazon and Facebook taking a new look at cities like Baltimore and Cleveland and opening up there. And finally, government. Government investing in infrastructure, better public transit, safer streets, continuing to clean up the environment. All four of these investments by real estate investors, entrepreneurs, people, and government, these are all synergistic in building up a more successful city. And Mac and I talk about the microeconomics of building such cities.
Thanks, Matt. So as you highlighted so well, the six cities that we study face an economic challenge today. All of them need to do a better job retaining people and businesses that are born and grow up in the city, while at the same time attracting new residents and new jobs. If they are able to stem population loss and bring more people and jobs to the city, this will help grow the tax base and increase the city's budget so that they can invest in quality of life improvements in disadvantaged neighborhoods. Our book focuses on the role of the private sector in these cities and how they interact with people, neighborhoods, and local governments. Now, after a surge in spending in the 1960s, federal expenditures on cities has been drastically reduced. Even the Obama administration targeted few large-scale programs, although several cities such as Detroit benefited briefly from the American Recovery Act. And while Baltimore will likely benefit from increases in federal spending, such as Biden's proposed $3 trillion stimulus plan, at a larger scale, the federal government is unlikely to bail these cities out. As such, it is crucial that these cities develop homegrown solutions to the problems they face. So today in our talk, I'm going to present some brief facts about the history of our six cities and the problems that they face, look at some promising recent trends, and think about the future of investing in post-industrial cities. We believe that it is even more important to invest in these cities today than in the near future, given the uncertainty following COVID, the rise in work from home, and the increased fear of contagion in dense cities. So in this chart, we're looking at 40 years spanning from 1970 to 2010. During this period, all six of our cities lost more than 20% of their population, while during the same time, the U.S. grew by over 50%. In 1970, they all ranked among the top 25 largest cities in the U.S., but by 2010, they ranked among only the top 60. In 1970, Baltimore had 900,000 people. Today, it has just around 600,000. During the span of time, millions of people chose to leave these cities and live elsewhere. Other cities were growing while these cities were shrinking. In the mid-19th century, the steel mills of Pittsburgh and the car manufacturers of Detroit drove the economy of these cities, providing good-paying jobs to people with high school educations. This chart shows the decline in manufacturing jobs in the U.S., which is the blue dotted line, and our six cities from the 1960s to 2018. And during this period, while manufacturing jobs declined 35% nationally, they declined by over 75% in all six of our cities. These cities struggled to fill this gap in jobs with new businesses and enterprises. As people left these cities, investment in new housing declined. This chart shows the number of housing units built in our six cities and in the U.S. in the previous decade, for five periods in time from 1970 to 2010. So for the year 1970, this chart shows the number of housing units built from 1960 to 1970. So from 1970 to 2010, the number of new housing units built in the previous decade nearly doubled in the US from 12.5 million to 25 million. Meanwhile, the number of housing units built in our six cities declined in the range of 44% to 78%. As fewer new housing units were constructed, housing stock aged and deteriorated, posing environmental and public health risks and leaving existing residents with low quality housing options. These six cities are some of the most racially segregated cities in the US. These two charts depict the number of census tracts in our six cities by the share of African American population. The chart on the left is for 1970 and on the right is for 2010. Now, you'll see that while the number of integrated neighborhoods has risen slightly from the 1970s, by the 2010s, they were still highly segregated. Almost 45% of census tracts in the six cities that we look at had an African-American population above 80% in 2010. The legacies of redlining and white flight and disinvestment in majority Black communities has deeply influenced their history and development. This history casts a long shadow over our six cities. This chart depicts the number of homicides per 100,000 residents in the US, which is the line at the bottom of the chart, and in our six cities. While the crime rate has declined both nationally and in most US urban areas since the 1990s, homicide rates in our six cities remain high, and many have suffered from increases in recent years and even in this past year. Crime and homicide reduction remains a critical focus for these cities going forward and something they must begin to solve if they are able to succeed. So going back to what Matt discussed in our four pillars of investment, we're going to walk through each of those now and look at some aspects and examples of investment. So first, we're going to look at investing in people. One of the most important investments we can make as a society is in the education of people of all ages. But in our six cities, many young people are not able to reach their full potential due to a lack of investment in education. The research of the economist Raj Chetty at Harvard has highlighted that neighborhoods and cities such as Baltimore have some of the lowest levels of social and economic mobility of anywhere in the US. Simply put, many children growing up in Baltimore lack access to the opportunity and struggle to reach their full potential. The question becomes, what is the right investment? The Nobel laureate economist James Heckman has highlighted the enormous potential benefit to society of investing in the education and well-being of young children. Programs such as universal pre-kindergarten have proved popular and impactful in cities such as New York. There have been many well-publicized stories of children attempting to learn in freezing or sweltering classrooms in recent years in Baltimore, as well as a growing body of research that shows that children perform worse on standardized test scores on days where there's extreme heat and classrooms lack adequate cooling facilities. Recognizing this, Baltimore City Public Schools is investing in new school facilities with the 21st Century Schools program and trying to retrofit as many classrooms as possible with updated HVAC systems. But this is a costly endeavor and there's no cheap and easy solution. Research by our colleague Julia Burdick-Will in Sociology and Education has shown that violent crime exposure at school raises the probability that students will transfer in the following year. Many Baltimore City students have been traumatized by experiencing violence at a very young age. Recognizing this, last year, Baltimore passed a trauma-informed care task force program to start to help address this issue. As we stated earlier, these cities have lost many manufacturing jobs, whereas several decades ago, one could earn a decent wage with just a high school degree. Higher levels of education and skill and certifications are required to earn a living wage in our 21st century economy. Given that thousands of people return from long spells of incarceration every year in our six cities and need good jobs in order to thrive and turn their lives around, a crucial question is, how do we help returning citizens get jobs? An example of a program that seeks to address this is Lazarus Wright, which is run by Christopher Irvin in Baltimore, the gentleman at the far right of the photo. The program provides mentorship, education, and training for returning citizens and other marginalized groups, and helps them obtain commercial driver's license so they can go on to work jobs as truck drivers, earning $60,000 a year. So as noted earlier, our cities struggle with persistent high homicide and violent crime rates. Current strategies to reduce crime are clearly not working, and as such, these cities need to experiment with new strategies. Economist Jens Ludwig at the University of Chicago used a randomized control trial to study the Becoming a Man cognitive behavioral therapy program. He found that participation in the program reduced total arrests during the intervention period by 28 to 35%, reduced arrests by 45 to 50%, and increased graduation rates by 12 to 19%. He also trialed a similar program in a juvenile justice detention center and found reduced recidivism rates by 20%. His team also estimated benefit cost ratios and found them to be in the range of 5 to 1 to 30 to 1, providing evidence that cognitive behavioral therapy programs can be a cost-effective intervention. What these programs do is they help young adults slow down and think about the consequences of their actions before acting impulsively. Baltimore City announced last year that it's going to implement a violence reduction strategy, which is an evidence-based approach designed to help reduce violent crime, expand opportunities for high-risk populations, and build better relationships between police officers and the communities they serve. The city tried this program in the 1990s and 2010s, but never achieved the level of coordination or political buy-in to fully implement. Johns Hopkins and several local foundations are pledging financial support for various aspects of the program. Other programs, such as ROCA and the Safe Streets Violence Interrupter Program, have seen early success, but are still small scale. Importantly, we need to find violence reduction programs that are not just scientifically based, but have the full backing and support of the communities where they will be implemented. This is crucial for ultimate success. Now we're going to pivot to another one of the four pillars of this. Businesses. In Baltimore, almost 50% of businesses are Black-owned. Yet Black-owned businesses make up only 9% of employer firms in the city. They employ just 2% of all workers in the city, and they have less than 1% of the total revenue of all employer firms. It is clear to us that Baltimore would be much better off if these businesses were able to reach their full potential. So why aren't they? Access to capital is a huge issue, as a lack of collateral and equity prevent many Black-owned firms from getting loans, and many don't have the family and friends startup funding necessary to invest in the early growth of a business. Black-owned businesses have just a third of the available startup capital of white businesses. The economists Alicia Robb and Robert Fairley have studied racial disparities in access to lending and access to capital, and have found that even after controlling for credit scores and credit worthiness, Black-owned businesses are less likely to obtain the capital they need. They also found that Black business owners reported being three times more likely to fear loan application rejection than their white counterparts. Anchor institutions such as universities, hospitals, and other large local employers can have a significant impact on local employment and business development beyond their own organization if they're able to commit to sourcing locally. So after the 2015 unrest in Baltimore, Johns Hopkins partnered with several other large local employers such as M&T Bank, the construction company, Whiting Turner, and Baltimore Gas and Electric to set public goals to engage in more local hiring and purchasing. In the first year after this initiative, they reported an increase in millions of dollars of local spending. Now, while this can have a significant impact for many existing businesses that are large or growing, smaller businesses may struggle to have the capacity to take on large contracts coming from such big firms, which is why Johns Hopkins partnered with Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Businesses program, which seeks to address this by engaging small and minority-owned businesses in technical assistance training programs, which help them access the resources required to grow and scale their efforts. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the traditional financial system is not meeting the needs of many Black-owned businesses in our cities. Alternative lending models are needed. Initiatives such as the microlending program Kiva, recently expanding to cities including Baltimore, providing a matching service for local entrepreneurs looking for funding and local people who want to fund these projects. Community Development Financial Institutions, or CDFIs, are private financial institutions that focus on lending to underserved communities. In 2017, Baltimore City did not have a locally headquartered CDFI that engaged in small business lending. That changed with the creation of Baltimore Business Lending, a program of Baltimore Community Lending. An example of a loan that they made was to a Black-owned wine shop called Off the Rocks that wanted to open a store in an upcoming neighborhood. They needed a microloan to buy a fridge, but they lacked collateral. BBL was able to get them a loan despite this. They repaid it early. The lender knew that they had a good business plan and that they had the skills to succeed as a small business. They just weren't able to access capital in the traditional way. They're also piloting a character-based lending program that will provide loans to returning citizens who are aspiring entrepreneurs. We need more models like this if Black-owned businesses are able to succeed in our cities. So our six cities have seen tremendous growth in startups and venture capital raised in the last decade. A potential issue of concern is that Baltimore becomes a farm team where companies come out of Johns Hopkins and other universities start up in the city, but then leave for Boston, New York, and the Bay Area once they get to a real growth stage and need large financing rounds. Pittsburgh, one of our six cities, is famous for reinventing its economy around robotics and AI, with the success of Carnegie Mellon generating some of this startup activity. Recognizing the success, Johns Hopkins Tech Ventures sought a similar path in Baltimore and was able to drive significant investments in companies and help the city retain them as they grew instead of leaving for some of these other cities. In the past decade, Baltimore has seen significant improvements in retention of startups and locally sourced finance. So next we're going to talk about investing in places, which by which we mean, you know, physical neighborhoods within our six cities. As I mentioned earlier in the presentation, as Matt mentioned, our six cities have tens of thousands of vacant houses that pose serious environmental and health risks. Baltimore alone has 16,000 vacant houses. These cities also have old manufacturing buildings and mills from their industrial plants that sit unused, as well as brownfield sites. In Baltimore, just east of the harbor, lies the Harbor East neighborhood that used to be home to a chromium. It is now home to an Exelon office building that is surrounded by some of the best restaurants in the city, high-priced condos, and excellent retail opportunities. Along the Jones Falls River that runs through Baltimore in the Hampton neighborhood, old mills are being converted into mixed-use spaces with loft apartments and commercial space on the ground floor. Now, while this is promising, these cities should be ready to confront the challenges of rising rents and displacement and gentrification if these neighborhoods do see sudden sharp increases in investment. In our book, we explore the ideas of community-based real estate investment trusts and community land trusts as potential guardrails. Just last week, Baltimore City awarded over $2 million to three community land trusts in the city to build permanently affordable housing units. These are some ways that cities can protect existing renters against some of the bad effects of gentrification.
Mac, thanks so much. For decades, I have been very interested in green cities. My first book was titled Green Cities, Urban Growth of the Environment. It was not a bestseller. But the big idea of my Green Cities book from like 20 years ago was that cities that offer a great quality of life, the mayor can be confident that there will always be a tax base, that footloose people and jobs will seek out that place. And as a resident of Baltimore, and I know a fair bit of all about all six of our cities, an optimistic trend going forward is the rising demand to live in green cities, especially among young people and people whose kids are outside of school age. There is this rising demand to live in green cities. And fortunately, in each of our six cities, there's been tremendous improvement in recent years in reducing ambient lead exposure and PM2.5 exposure. So small particulate matter is very bad for one's health and one's well-being. China wrestles with these issues now, India's cities now as well. And so a promising trend in all six of our cities is cleaning up the waterfront, improving local air quality, and investment in parks. There's synergies there. If a city is safer, local parks are more valuable to people as their children can play there. And such parks and open space also offer plenty of opportunity, both for leisure and for flood control. And so our book is strong, talking about how environmental protection is actually a pro-growth strategy as cities reposition themselves to improve their quality of life. A major theme in our book and at Johns Hopkins right now is the big data revolution. So each of us is both a consumer and a producer of big data. So when you're on Facebook or another social media app, you are generated data, and you're also a consumer of such data. And so in Baltimore today, and in several of our other six cities, there's something very exciting going on. And Mayor Brandon Scott, as a younger man, played a key role here. there's been a rise in Baltimore of collecting more data of what goes on in the city. And this allows for great map making. So in New York City, back 20 years ago with this CompuStat, of geocoding where crime is occurring in a city can help the police to better pinpoint where there's an emerging issue and helps them to make more informed decisions about police tactics. But the same issue arises in many settings. And Mac, I think we should talk about this in the Q&A. For every challenge that cities face, whether it's litter, whether it's crime, whether it's 311 calls, the urban big data revolution creates accountability as officials know that the citizens will be able to use GIS maps to map out and to study trends over time on which neighborhoods face a challenge, whether it's garbage pickup or whether it is car break-ins, and then to hold their elected officials accountable if progress does not occur. And such big data also is very important for testing whether proposed interventions are successful. For example, in Philadelphia, there was a piloted program to see if you change the light bulbs to better light up the streets at night, does that reduce crime? And because researchers could access the city's geocoded data by day, by location, by time, the researchers were able to do a treatment control comparison, just like with the Johns Hopkins medical study of a drug, to see whether lights at night help to reduce crime. And the answer is yes. And so that's an example of how the urban big data revolution fuels problem diagnosis, like a clinical doctor, and also informs policy experimentation as we seek out to identify what are cost-effective solutions. So in our second to last chapter of the book, we point out several emerging trends that make us cautious optimists about our cities. And Mac is a homeowner in Baltimore. He has made a bet, and I believe he's very proud of his bet. So again, this is the age of the consumer city. Even post-COVID, I remain highly optimistic about our cities, about city life in general. And our six cities sort of solve a Goldilocks issue. They're large enough that they have interesting consumer opportunities. If you're a beer drinker, Baltimore offers so many opportunities. At the same time, they're not so dense like New York City to face issues that we continue to worry about in our post-pandemic economy. Each of our cities has thriving immigrant clusters, a Bosnian community in St. Louis, Detroit having very successful communities of immigrants. There's wonderful selection there. My grandfather was an immigrant from Poland, of seeking out opportunity in our country. Young people continue to want to live in cities. There is a question in each of our cities about public school quality, and for families, when they have school-age children, will they move to the suburbs? A test of whether our cities are making a comeback is whether young people in cities remain there when they have school-age kids. In our new age of remote work, it has been estimated that one-third of us may be engaging in remote work 2 or 3 days a week going forward. And for the educated, roughly half of all college graduates may be engaging in remote work. Mac and I believe that the rise of work from home opens up tremendous opportunities for our cities. Baltimore could become a suburb of Washington, D.C. as people purchase cheap, beautiful housing in the city of Baltimore and then engage in remote work and perhaps go to Washington, D.C. 1 or 2 days a week via a fast train. Same thing for Philadelphia. So among our cities, some have tremendous potential as work from home hubs. Mac and I also are very interested in the decisions of Facebook, Amazon, and Google in where they choose to open up their smaller headquarters. And a test of whether our six cities are really making a comeback is, in the future, will companies like Amazon, when it opens HQ3, will Baltimore and our other cities compete better to attract these? That's, to me, a market test of their comeback. So to wrap up before we open up our Q&A, we have presented to you each of the four pillars of success. And I want to highlight now the synergies between them. For example, let us do people and government. If young people in Baltimore do not view the city to have future economic opportunity, if they do not view the city to be safe, unfortunately, economics predicts that such individuals will study less hard in school. To flip that around, if you are very optimistic that the economy where you're going to live your adult life is booming, and you're very optimistic that you could live to age 100, you have an extra incentive to study when you're young because you have such a long profile of time in the rest of your life to earn the benefits of making that upfront investment. And so my teacher, the Nobel laureate Gary Becker, wrote down economic models of the investment in human capital. So to say this again, if people feel that there is going to be a booming future local economy, and if they're optimistic about safety and their health and mental health, they will invest more in their training when young because it's a more profitable investment. That's an example of how these puzzle pieces fit together. Let's do one more. Businesses will be more likely to open up in our cities if they think that there is a well-trained workforce. That connects the synergies between business and people. Real estate investors will be more likely to invest if they believe that there is a thriving economy. And so all the puzzle pieces fit together. Matt, can I bring you in there?
So before we get to questions, I wanted to briefly discuss this photo, which I chose for the cover of our book. In the photo, we're looking at the abandoned Old Town Mall, which is located in the Old Town neighborhood of Baltimore. And we're looking through the Old Town Mall onto the glittering tall buildings of Baltimore's downtown Inner Harbor. So for me, looking at this photo, it really highlights how two neighborhoods within the same city, just mere miles apart, can feel worlds apart. One neighborhood, the downtown, has seen hundreds of millions of dollars in investment redevelopment and has been the focus of investors and city government for decades. The other, this neighborhood, the Old Town Mall, is a part of the city that has seen cycles of investment and disinvestment in the past 50 years. Most recently, the mall was heralded as a shining example of urban revitalization after it was developed into a pedestrian-only commercial district and mall after the 1968 riots. But by the 1980s, the mall had declined again as drug dealing proliferated in the neighborhood around it and unemployment and job loss engulfed it. So the area contains a plot of land that was once home to Bel Air Market, which had operated there from 1813 to the early 2000s when the city tore it down to encourage development. However, in recent years, the city uses the area to dump loud snow. In the past decade, there have been several failed attempts to redevelop this area. Currently, it's part of an ambitious $1 billion redevelopment plan that includes over 200 acres of East Baltimore. But whether the plan will be realized and the area will rise again are unknown. But for anybody who visits Baltimore or lives here and walks or drives by the area, it's clear that there is real potential here. And if it got the investment it needed, this could be a vibrant commercial area with excellent residential opportunities in the surrounding neighborhood. And this is, you know, really one of the key themes that we discuss in our book, the potential of neighborhoods like this to rise and realize their full potential. So now we can open things up to questions from the audience. And we have a question here from Jenna. Are there any cities that have employed educational models that have demonstrated good success in recruiting and retaining teachers who look like the students that they serve? So, Matt, before I give it over to you, I think I briefly mentioned that Baltimore City a couple of years ago began a work group to look at this issue specifically around retaining Black teachers because they found a very high turnover rate. And our colleague in the Hopkins Economics Department, Nicholas Papageorge, has done some great research showing the beneficial effect of same race for student teacher on educational expectations. So there is a big impact here. And Baltimore City's public schools certainly realize this. So they're trying to do certainly a better job of investing in these teachers and making sure that they stay and don't burn out, because teacher burnout is a real serious issue faced in all six of our cities.
I really like Jenna's question. Jenna, as I think about the answer to your question, so as Matt just said, my colleague Nick Papageorge and co-authors wrote this very exciting paper where they had data on the school performance of different young people. And as I remember the results, and to repeat what Max said, putting on our statistics hat, these scholars documented that all else equal, a young African-American student gains more in test scores and other indicators when he or she is taught at certain key ages by an African-American teacher. And if this result generalizes to other populations, then as an economist, I want to pay such teachers more more money to consider being teachers. I chose to be an economist. It's an interesting question. How would I have done as a 10th grade teacher? Jenna, my concern is public school teachers in Baltimore are unionized. Would the union allow superstar teachers to be paid more? The free market economist to me would like to pay more to those individuals who have scarce skills. LeBron James is paid more than me. If it is the case that minority children gain more from having minority teachers, I want them to be paid more to bring more of them into the field. I do not know if public sector union contracts allow that, but I think this is a very important question.
Mac? I've got another great question here from Chris. I'm glad he brought this up because it's something that we do discuss in our book, but we didn't mention in our presentation today. So Chris asks, what impact do you think the recent decriminalization of drug-related crimes in many cities will have on urban communities? And I want to start out by saying, you know, I think it was last week, Baltimore City State Attorney Marilyn Mosby announced that she's going to continue to not penalize some of these drug-related crimes. And I actually read a great article by Ron Cassie in Baltimore Magazine that highlighted Baltimore Mayor Kirk Schmoke, who was an early advocate of this in Baltimore. And it's a really great story. I encourage you to look it up, about how Kirk Schmoke in the 90s, who was then mayor of Baltimore, and he had three terms. He's now the president of the University of Baltimore, and actually gave our book a great review. But there's this really interesting story of him going to the U.S. Conference of Mayors in the 1990s and proposing exactly this, the decriminalization of drug-related crimes. He saw the impact, the negative impact it was having on communities, and how Baltimore wasn't getting any safer by targeting these types of low-level arrests. But he was really lambasted in the national press. Everybody jumped on him for being a proponent of this. And today you have, it's extremely popular. So, this is, I think, a really good example of somebody who is trying to push innovative policy decades ago, but it seemed just too early for a lot of the public to swallow it.
I would only add on Chris's point. I think back to my own teenage years, and I want to believe that America is the nation of second chances. And I think of some of the stupid things I did as a teen. And I think all young people. So the interesting question is, coming back to the theme of our book, under a decriminalization of certain offenses, will more teenagers in our six cities achieve their full potential? with sociologists, I would love to interview some of these young people. What are their dreams? What do they aspire to do? And for those who choose to enter the field of drug dealing, why? In the language of economics, what was their next best opportunity? If they had been mentored, would they have stayed in some math class? What happened to their time allocated to studying as they took up these other activities? And so a key question I have is, what are new rules of the game for teenagers in our six cities such that they make greater investments in their skills and health? And I think it's tied to expectations about the local economy and whether they're valued as people. Mac, what do you think of that?
Yeah, I mean, I think it completely changes the potential that young people will see in their future. If they don't see a lot of their friends getting locked up for, low-level offenses, it really highlights the possibility that they can achieve. So Matt, I'm going to pose this question to you first, and then I'll follow up. It's a labor economics question. So Abram asks, won't the impact of robotics and automation undercut programs that aim to provide jobs to those with less than a college education? So this is all about the rise of automation and the potential loss of jobs for people with high school education, which I think, you know, now looking at a post-COVID world, there's increased attention on this issue.
So Abram's raising a central issue that my friend David Auder and Daron Acemoglu at MIT are the leaders in thinking about whether robots are our friend, or do they displace us, or do they create new opportunities for us? And when I teach Econ 101, I think about, am I doing a better job than a robot? So I face competition from robots. Mac, the central issue with Abram's question is, I think that our comparative advantage, which is the fancy econ word for what is our edge, facing robots, our comparative advantage is personality and face-to-face interaction, almost the hospitality industry. And so Abram's question is very important. I would hope that community colleges and those training people are thinking through what could be jobs that will survive in an economy where there's more and more robots. And I think that these relate to custom crafts. I think these relate to personality skills. So Mac, as a beer drinker, could a robot make a craft brew? Or once we have the blueprint, it could make the craft brew.
Yeah, and these are important questions. I mean, creativity is something that is hard to replace. It's hard to write an algorithm so that a robot can paint a beautiful picture. It just doesn't have the same experience. And I think, again, COVID has highlighted that people really enjoy interpersonal interaction. And I don't think, even though there might be a increased hesitancy to do something like engage with a waiter in a restaurant, I don't think by and large that people are going to want to completely automate their experience with businesses. So I think there is a future here. It just might look a little different than what we know in the past. So have another question here from Casey, who asks, are there any examples of business-to-business mentorship models to build and strengthen smaller and local businesses? And before I hand this over to you, Matt, I wanted to give an example of a company in Baltimore that we actually highlight in our book called Fearless Solutions, which is a Black-owned software and website developer and designing company in the city, which has been amazingly successful. And the owner of that company actually cited one of the reasons for his and the company's major success was really good mentors in Baltimore. And I think it's often undervalued. So what you have in Baltimore City is you have a lot of accelerators, a lot of local sort of startup environments where businesses get, you know, co-working spaces, they get a little bit of funding, they get the opportunity to pitch their ideas to investors. But I think what's really important are the networks that they're able to build, not only in working with other startups, but being able to interact with people who have already gone through the process and know some of the pitfalls that they might encounter. So I think this issue of mentorship is still really important, but I think it's in a way it's undervalued because it's hard to you know really pin down what exactly it is. There's not a dollar amount attached to it. There's not a space attached to it. It really is an important sort of experience in helping businesses grow.
I want to pick up on Mac's point, and I really like where Casey's taking us. Mac, I want to tell you a story from China and my work in China cities that I never told you. And Mac hears too many of my stories. CG and I started a project on the equivalent of WeWork in China. So folks, WeWork and the company's had some trouble in recent years, but I view it as a brilliant idea. It's about sharing common space. It's almost like going back to college again as an entrepreneur. If you had your own room in a dorm where you have your own little business, but you can go out to the common kitchen area. And Mac, what CG and I were talking about was to have full access to one of these common workspace areas and to know each of the clients who had rented space in the area and to figure out the social interactions between the businesses. And one of our hypotheses was to study mentorship of which firms which were having success. Were they talking to startups? And was there any evidence of this mentorship? But Mac, this project did not occur. But I thought that this would be the way, as I think about Casey's question, do we achieve mentorship because Mac and I are in the same church? Because Mac and I both went to Johns Hopkins and I'm age 50 and he's age 25, or because I've had a startup business for 5 years and Mac has had a startup business for 2 years. In cities, all these different interactions occur. And what I love about Casey's question is I don't know the answer to it, and it speaks about how to collect new data there. Mac, any thoughts there?
Yeah, I mean, I think it is a data question. Is we know that cities are great, and why one of the many reasons economists love them is because there is all this interaction between a wide range of different people. But it's again hard to understand what I get from interacting with you versus another colleague versus an undergraduate in Baltimore versus an alumni. And because of that, it's hard to tease out exactly the role that sort of these different touch points play. But what's clear is that there's something going on here that's successful. And so I think what we need is definitely more models of sort of business to business mentorship to begin to understand, you know, really what is it that's making the difference here. So Matt, you mentioned that you wanted to go back to the issue of big data. So got a question from Ray here. Has the introduction of big data and its availability to the public affected the trade-off between short-term and long-term goals? I would think, he says, I would think that it shifts the focus toward more short-term goals. And this is a great question, again, because it's something that we highlight in the book, but that we didn't talk about today is the issue of short-term agendas for politicians versus sort of taking the longer view.
Mac, two thoughts on Ray's important question. I have argued, I want to crack a half joke. I have argued that mayors should be paid with plots of land in the city. Because if you paid a mayor with land in the city, he or she would have a long-term perspective. Because if you own a piece of land in a city, you are entitled to the rental flow on that property into the infinite future. And so, Mac, now to answer Ray's question, since I see no one found my joke funny. Anyway, Ray, if... So Mac is a homeowner in Baltimore. And if due to big data, he realizes that there's been a deterioration in garbage pickup in his neighborhood, or there is more crime in his neighborhood, if Mac gets activated as a homeowner to protest this because his home value will decline if quality of life declines, I believe that if big data access and digestion of that data leads local homeowners to activate and to get concerned, that mayors will be more likely to step up and address the issue. So if you believe that logic chain, homeowners as a vested interest group in the city's future, if they wake up from whatever they were doing and get concerned and active because big data is shared by the Baltimore Sun or by nerds like me and Mac, that this can push a short-term interested mayor to play the long game and to make investments that make the city stronger in the long run. Mac, do you give that a B+?
I give it an A. So building on the issue of big data, have another question from Lena. And she asks, your solutions rely on a lot of surveillance via big data and the private sector's discretion to do the right thing. How are you considering the ethics here? And I think in Baltimore, there's a good example with the recent plane surveillance system that the police department trialed. And I think, you know, one of the issues there was a lack of transparency and accountability in both what was being gathered in terms of data and how it was being used. So as Matt mentioned earlier, Baltimore has a really great open data website portal where you can go on and you can see, you know, anybody can go on and look through a wide variety of data sources. You know, the city department that's generating this data. And so I think to the extent where it's possible to make the data open and transparent, it's important. And where there is confidential data, you know, I think we just need to do a better job, all of us, of saying exactly what we're doing with that data, what we're not doing with that data, how it's being made safe, and how we're not surveilling people. But really trying to work with governments and other entities to evaluate the success or failure of programs.
Let me pick up on Mac's very important point and on Lena's point. My mother is a civil liberties lawyer, and I'm very sensitive to the issues that Lena raises. Let me give a couple of examples of big data that are not Orwellian. Zillow. So Mac and I have been using Zillow real estate data to study monthly price dynamics by zip code. Think of the zip code where you live. Zillow is taking data on every sales transaction and using some simple algebra you were taught at Hopkins early on, and you might have studied when you were a 10th grader. And Zillow is taking these data to allow us to study by month, going back 30 years for every zip code, home price dynamics. That's an example of seeing which neighborhoods are gentrifying, which neighborhoods are not doing well over time. I always think by what ifs. What if nerds like me and Mac did not have access to these big data? In that case, we can't bring about accountability. I think it's very important in capitalism to hold different entities accountable. If the schools are not doing a good job educating children, how do we know that? And how do the schools know that we know that they're not doing a good job? Do we just rely on the honors system? At Johns Hopkins, we have final exams. Students have private information about how they're doing in a course, and professors can only elicit that information by having an exam. That's an example of how we use a mechanism to reveal information so that we can update our beliefs. Our goal is to help the new generation of children born in Cleveland, Detroit, and Baltimore achieve their full potential. Mac and I are cautiously optimistic, but we don't believe in magic. To achieve the gains for the current residents of these cities, the homeowners of these cities, and their children, we need four levels of investment. in the real estate stock, in new businesses, in the people, and in the place. And I believe that only through big data collection and analysis can we bring about the accountability. Because at the end of the day, it's incentives, not good intentions, that makes an area stronger. And I fundamentally believe that in my training in economics, my 30 years as an economist, the one message I have is incentives matter. They don't always have to be monetary. They can be social incentives, prestige, being known as a good mentor, being a good person in your community. But at the end of the day, big data helps to hold people accountable. We see in NBA basketball right now, these players seeking a better contract. There's a question, are they a good player? What analytics allows us to know whether they make their team stronger? Same idea in making our city stronger.
And Matt, I want to discuss one more issue around this that I know we've talked a lot about, a whole lot about, is the issue of air pollution in cities. So right now, in Baltimore City, there is one air pollution monitor that is used to measure PM2.5, this fine particulate matter that can cause a whole host of problems when it's at high levels. And from that, some nerds estimate what the levels are in other areas of the city, but we really don't know differences across neighborhoods. So people, it could be the fact that people are walking around certain neighborhoods in Baltimore and exposing them to very high levels of air pollution. If we were able to put local monitors in, say, 50 or 100 different neighborhoods in Baltimore, we could begin to learn more about what the dynamics of air pollution are at the local level. We could make this information public, and the public could engage in both avoidance activity, or we could have targeted programs that try to lower levels of air pollution and address some of these disparities in the city.
Great point.
So we've got another question here. Last question from RSD, who says, Amazon sees Baltimore as a warehouse city with jobs paying $12 an hour. How do you see that changing?
RSB's question is very important, and it comes back to this crucial philosophical question of the fairness of capitalism. My hope is twofold in the case of Amazon. As Baltimore's new generation of kids acquire more skill through better education and more mentoring in their communities, with more skill, one earns a higher wage, and that Amazon would bring more jobs and higher quality jobs to Baltimore if we can match with a more skilled workforce. I'd also say that Amazon has not located its headquarters or HQ2 in Baltimore or our other five cities. As our cities improve their quality of life, and I mentioned this during our slides, that these superstar companies will be more likely to open up branches. And if they do, having such vice presidents of the Facebooks, the Google, the Amazons located in our cities creates this multiplier effect through the local multiplier effect of creating service jobs. Mac, these questions have been fantastic, and we encourage you to stay in touch with us by visiting our 21st Century Cities page. And Mac, am I right that chapter one of our book is available for free there?
Yep. So if you go on our website, 21cc.jhu.edu, you can read the first chapter of the book for free. And we also have a series of talks with top economists and urban experts from around the U.S. discussing some of our cities and some of the issues that we've discussed today. So hope you can check that out if you're interested. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this opportunity, and thank you for joining us.